published. Early estimates of the damage at £500,000 seem almost certain to be too low.
The very stones themselves have split in the searing heat, and any rebuilding seems unlikely. It's a blackened shell. The cause is still unknown. Arson hasn't been discounted, but it seems unlikely. The seat of the fire, high above the chapel ceiling, was not easily accessible. A 15th century painting of the Last Supper was among the many treasures lost forever, along with many stained glass windows.
I went there and found the whole school outside watching the chapel flames, which was about 9:30, I suppose. And by that time, it was quite clear that it was on fire.
Some people, however, clearly just marvelled at the spectacle of it all, and you can understand that.
The director of music had his organ music up in the loft, and that was all destroyed, sadly. It's a long, you know, it's a big collection of pieces that I'd acquired over many years.
Legend has it that on the morning service of September the 17th, the former Ferox housemaster, Mr. Burns, gave a speech titled Tongues of Fire. Mysteriously, around half an hour later, the whole building set ablaze and the glorious chapel was consumed by the tongues of fire.
Had before was an Edwardian grey sensation, like a lot of schools of this type. They had their chapels built about the same time.
I haven't really got to know the chapel and the school so well, and so it doesn't really bother me as much as many of the people who are very distressed.
The ceiling was changed completely because the fire started between the plaster and the roof. So there's this enormous loft space. Now there is no loft space. They're too tightly together, so there's no air between them.
The fundamental cause of the catastrophic fire that was later discovered was the ceiling. The workers, who were refurbishing near the rooftop, used electrical devices that caused small sparks to set off an enormous fire that rapidly spread through the entirety of chapel.
I've not heard anyone say they don't like this instrument. It was smaller, but it had a bigger scale, it's called, so some of the noises were enormously exciting. And it stood one bay further in an island on its own. Sat over there, facing this way, so in order to see the conductor I had to lean back and look out, and now I can see what I need to in this screen. And the keyboard, if this is of any use, has to face this way, because it is connected mechanically. There's no electronic stuff. Was the bit that was the most flammable. There's a lot of lead, wood, and other substances which very easily caught fire. And so it was the last thing to go out, so there was nothing left at all. And someone suggested that we needn't look at British instruments exclusively, so that's why we went to Germany. And then we appointed an organ consultant who just retired from being the organist of Westminster Abbey. He advised us to go to Denmark to look at the builder we have here. So that process was quite good fun. We had a bit of world travel and playing in amazing, wonderful cathedrals in Germany and churches in Copenhagen and in the United States, in New York. And then eventually, of course, it turned into what did we want? What stops do we want? What sounds do we want? How big could we have it? So Mark Husson could give us everything we wanted, for the price we could afford. Mm-hmm. And they have done a fantastic job. This building was still here, and two-thirds of the walls were still here, and it was a shell, and you'd still have to do something with the shell.
Well, after the chapel burned down, there was lots of different ideas about what was going to happen to the chapel.
And there was a plan to build a chapel on the Upper Hundred.
And to have it in a much more modern style of architecture, and to be able to use the chapel perhaps as some kind of theatre as well.
One of the objections to it was that if you were batting and you were facing it, all of the front was glass, but the reflected sun, you wouldn't see your bowler properly.
I can't help but assume and believe that actually the loss of the chapel and then the existential kind of question about what is the purpose of a chapel, why do we have one, that then led to the debate about what was going to be built and where and in what form.
It took 7 years for the process of not having a chapel to having a chapel. That was a 7-year disruption to a lot of people's work, and a whole generation of boys, of course, never had one because that generation is 5 years. People said, they used slightly emotional language about it, but they said, if this is the heart of the school, then why would you transplant the heart to a different place? And it seemed so obvious that this is where it should be. There were people, of course, who said, don't spend any more than the insurance money, or don't build a chapel at all.
The then headmaster, Mr. Everett, was very clear when he said that the word that came to his mind was the word
resurrection. And that expresses exactly the feeling we all have, and actually coming in, I feel even more strongly.
It took a lengthy 7 years and £7 million to fully rebuild Chapel. But in 1995, under the headmastership of Martin Hammond, Chapel was fully rebuilt and reconsecrated, and it once again became the heart of the school.
I think when people come in here, they do acknowledge that there's a wow factor about it.
This plaque, really, as it says actually, was created in, as far as we know, 1663, and it was created by the Skinners Company, who of course founded the school, and it commemorated their having created a gallery in the west end of the church, St Peter and St Paul, specifically for the purpose of the pupils to be able to attend services and use the church as their chapel. And so this is a dedication by the Skinners Company with their motto, "To God only be all glory," and celebrating the relationship between the school and the church, kind of affirmed by the Skinners Company.
The chapel is for the boys, and it's not for me. Some people say, oh, it's wonderful that you have this great chapel. But actually, it's the chapel for the boys, and it's for the OTs as well.
In my opinion, it still looks like it's new. It's lighter, it's larger. It's a taller building, and it's a brighter building, and it's a fresher building, and I would say a nicer building.
Where the whole school comes together as a group, both the staff and the boys. It's the only place where we can all be together.
Because I think it's one of those things you realise that the benefit of, the value of, perhaps later in life even, but perhaps not necessarily always in that moment. Thought and reflection, and we have one that is beautiful to enjoy for many, many decades to come.